Here's a great British story. A three-year-old Labradoodle helped a woman who was found in a very emotionally distressed state on a motorway bridge. This is Digby, the therapy dog, who usually helps staff at Devon and Somerset Fire Service. They normally help them after they coped with traumatic emergencies, but he was brought over to the scene over the M5 in Devon on Tuesday. The lady moved to a safe position when she was asked if she wanted to meet Digby. And that got us thinking at GB News about therapy dogs. Now, joining me to discuss this is Lois Wyatt from Therapy Dogs Nationwide and Head Dog Gunnar. Now, I have to say a little confession here. Don't mind admitting this. I'm quite frightened of dogs. And when someone told me I had to have a dog on, I was a little bit anxious. Then, when I saw Gunnar arrive, is it a boy dog?
He's a boy.
Yeah, yes, he is. He's quite big. So he's I was quite boy. Frightened. But then he's just kind of laid down. I don't know if he's asleep or what he's doing down there. But
no, he's very much awake, Michelle. Very
oh,
much
is he?
Awake. Yes.
Oh, he's a very good dog. Tell me. So I don't actually feel that anxious. So I'm because I am a bit anxious sometimes
really?
With dogs. Yeah. So Gunnar's a therapy dog.
He is indeed, yes.
What does he do?
The therapy dogs don't do so much. They just are. So he's very calm. As you can see, he's very chilled, very relaxed, and he gives off an aura about him that takes stress out of us humans. So he works with children. He works a lot with people who have dog phobia.
Yeah.
and he just de-stresses. So children, say, care homes we visit. The organisation Therapy Dogs Nationwide visit all sorts of institutions across the whole of the nation, which is wonderful.
And how does a dog become a therapy dog? I'm assuming there's training involved and...
No, they're not trained. Each of the therapy dogs is my pet. They are all our pets. And it's because I saw in him his calmness, his love of people, and that he just flumps down.
Well, yeah, I've got to say, yeah, when he arrived, he is pretty ginormous, isn't he? And I was a little bit like, oh, God, that's huge.
And he would probably pick that up from you, that you are a little anxious. So he won't come to you unless he thought that you wanted him to.
Oh, right.
So it's something we see in our pets that we think will make a wonderful therapy dog. And then they are assessed. And that's the critical phase. They have to pass an assessment.
Yeah.
And once they pass the assessment, then we're given the green light and then we are invited to go to schools, care homes, hospitals, wherever we're invited to. And Gunnar and I, throughout his career, have been to lots and lots of institutions, including Parliament, where there were 15 of us visited Parliament in May 2019.
Was that to try and relax the stressed-out MPs?
Not so much the MPs.
Oh.
It was the MPs and their staff. And
it was
the MP in my own area who knew what Gunnar did locally. And we just had a conversation one day. And I said, gosh, you must be awfully stressed up there. So it was 2019, so Brexit, et cetera, et cetera. And he said, oh, yes. I said, you need Gunnar. He said, we do. And then he said, but dogs aren't allowed. And then he went away and he actually got permission for the dogs to go. So my wonderful charity sent 15 dogs. We had a Chihuahua. And we had a Great Dane, a Labrador, a Retriever. Our trustees came down with their dogs. It was just wonderful. And everybody said afterwards, it was the most relaxed, chilled, well-attended event ever at Portcullis House.
Really?
So it was wonderful.
Oh, well, there you go. So what does a therapy session involve? Because obviously Gunnar's just relaxing.
He is. He's just totally... This is what he does, basically. So in schools, he'll go in and he'll lay down in whatever room we're allocated. And then the children will come in to him and sit and read.
Right.
Or if they don't want to read to him, they'll have a little cuddle with him. Sometimes they'll cry into his fur because they're having a tough day.
Aww.
The reception children, the four-year-olds, obviously don't yet read, but they'll come and do a jigsaw with him. So they'll teach him the alphabet, or at least they think they're teaching him the alphabet. So they'll pick up a letter and know it's A, B or C if they do, or they'll know it's a picture of an apple, and they'll tell him and they'll put the jigsaw bits into the puzzle. So just communicate.
And what will Gunnar do whilst all this is going on?
He just watches. Sometimes he falls asleep, but I just tell them they're doing so well that they're making him very sleepy.
Oh, wow.
He's supposed to be awake.
And how old is Gunnar? Am I doing well? Because he looks like his... I'm not making him fall asleep or anything, am I? Soothing dulcet tone.
No, he's awake.
And how old is Gunnar?
He'll be 10 next week.
Right.
So, and he's been doing this since he was 10 months of age.
Wow. So. And how's COVID affected things then? Are you still allowed to go in places?
No, he was very depressed March, April last year. We were at Crufts last year. Then following that, we did our usual visit to the London Ambulance Station at Waterloo, where we see a lot of the 999 and the paramedics, the 999 call centre staff and the paramedics to de-stress, chill, relax.
Yeah.
And that was the last thing we did. And then Boris pulled the plug and said, you know, we can't go anywhere. So we haven't visited anywhere since. And today when I put his uniform on and said, Gunner, we're going to work, he really perked up. So we've come on the train here.
He was you so excited pleased. To come and see
yes,
me?
Yes, he absolutely was. Gunner,
why don't we...
Come on, tummy.
It's a good boy. For me. We should get him to stand up so that the viewers can see.
Oh, I want him to stand up now.
Yeah, can he stand up? I don't know how this works.
Come. Good lad.
Look, it's absolutely, you're absolutely ginormous, Gunnar.
He's over 7 stone, so he is a
seven
bit
more. Yeah. You weigh probably just a little bit less than me, yeah.
You sure you don't want to touch him, Michelle?
Oh, OK, then I shall go on then.
Come on.
He's not going to bite me, is he?
No,
I am a bit.
No, absolutely
I'm not really.
Not. No.
Hello,
just
Gunnar.
Come and say hello to him.
I'm not really like hello. A dog kind of person. Oh, he's soft, isn't he? Hello. Yeah, and he's absolutely, absolutely huge. Yeah, I can imagine for people that
who are
yeah, I imagine that
they. I mean, some of our volunteers visit prisons.
Oh, right.
So we go to sort of virtually every institution there is across Great Britain.
I want to very, very quickly, because I'm almost out of time, just tell me a really nice story, if you will, of one of your happiest memories, just briefly a happy memory to finish.
I don't know so much happy, but one that really touched me was we travelled a lot by train. We were going to visit a patient at a hospital who had severe mental health and terrible phobia of dogs. And we were up and down on this train all the time. And one day a lady got on and she was asking people for money and I didn't want to engage and then I did. And then a few visits later, she was on the train. She saw Gunner and came running towards him. Now, he just lays down. He doesn't really do very much. But he saw her coming towards him. He stood up. And she grabbed him by the neck and she was sobbing her heart out into his fur. Aww. And she just turned around to me and said, thank you so much. He knows I have autism, doesn't he?
Oh.
And she was homeless.
Oh,
and
what a lovely story.
Brought a real lump to my throat.
Oh, bless you.
And I'm still in touch with her today.
I love that.
She just loves him.
Well, I love that story. Well done to you and to Gunnar. You're clearly making a difference.
Thank you.
Done.
Thank you.